All right, Northern Lifers, welcome back to yet another moment where we're sitting down with one of the candidates for the October 19th federal election. Today we're sitting down with NDP candidate Paul Loewenberg. We want to learn a little bit more about Paul. We would like to learn a little bit more about the NDP policy, see how much Paul knows about it and how intelligently he can speak about it. I'm sure he'll do fine. I'm Mark Gentile, I'm the managing editor at northernlife.ca. I've got Darren McDonald here on my left, who is the political affairs reporter here at the paper. And of course, sitting across from me right now is the man himself, Mr. Paul Loewenberg.
Hello.
How are you doing today, Paul?
I'm good.
Yeah. Little chilly this morning. I think winter is coming to Northern Ontario.
Well, it is the season. They said that it was going to be a strong, warm fall, though, right?
Warm winter as well.
Warm,
yeah.
Warm winter. Yeah. That's what they're saying.
Big El Nino.
Yeah, big El Nino this year. So it's going to be a late, good for patio season.
Hey, there you
Hopefully.
Go.
Now, for anyone who may not be familiar with Paul Loewenberg, why don't you tell us a little bit about where people might know you from?
People will most notably will know me from the downtown businesses, from the Laughing Buddha and the Townhouse Tavern. I've been at the Townhouse Tavern for 22 years. We opened up the Buddha 10 years ago and have been working there since, working from expanding from a small place to 70 seats to 300 seats now, and 10 staff to 70 staff. And I've been bringing in music to the community for the Townhouse for all of that time, 22 years, and also for the Northern Lights Festival Boreal as the artistic director for the last 16 years.
Right. And the Townhouse and the Buddha are kind of, I don't know if this is fair or not, but they're kind of the hub of the downtown sort of hipster kind of scene in Sudbury. I mean, there's a lot, there's sort of a center of culture for a long time in Sudbury.
I'll accept that. The business strategy was that we wanted to challenge the community to have something good, to do something interesting. And this is the family that I've worked for all of this time has been very encouraging of that. I said we want to do something unique in the community, and I think a lot of different businesses now thrive in the community because they follow that model. They say, mm-hmm. We want to do something unique, we want to challenge the community to be a cultural community, to gather. And it works, and it gets people downtown, and it gets people hanging out, and it gets people to love our community.
You have a long history in the art scene here, mm-hmm. and in the music scene, yeah.
Well, I've been
and for people who don't know and can't see underneath Paul's suit jacket, he has a lot of tattoos. He's much cooler than the suit might project to some of you if you have a hang up about suits. I personally don't. I like suits. It's a nice suit. But tell us about. I mean, where does the music come from? Where is your interest in the art stem from?
Well, I've been a music fan all my life. When I was looking at universities when I was in high school in the 1980s, I was very enamored with the college radio station across the river from us in Sarnia, where I was growing up. And Port here in Michigan had this great radio station. And so one of the things I actually looked for at universities was, you know, do they have a campus radio station? And I looked, you know, Guelph, yes, they do. They didn't talk about it very much in their literature. Laurentian focused on, yes, we have a campus radio station. It's a community radio station. And I said, well, Sudbury, let's give that place a look. I moved up here. I loved it. I got involved with the radio station right away in September 89 and stayed involved with community radio for 25 years. And basically, I gave it up this year when things got really busy with the campaign, and did a weekly radio show. I love all kinds of music, so mm-hmm. that's a bit of the background for that kind of getting into the work with the Townhouse and the Northern Lights Festival Boreal is we needed to have a wide appreciation of all arts and culture and yeah. music and
I want to talk to you a bit about Northern Lights Festival Boreal, because mm-hmm. it is one of the premier festivals that Sudbury has.
Yes.
But I want to just touch on something you said there. You said when you came up here in '89, you fell in love with Sudbury. You felt you liked the city.
Yes.
What is it about Sudbury that attracted you to it?
It's the rocks, mm-hmm. the energy of a town in the process of changing, in the process of, it's a chrysalis stage, mm-hmm. you know, of having this interesting history that is so tied to the earth, and mm-hmm. now it's spreading its wings and still holding. And I love the roots of Sudbury, and I you know, never want people to look poorly upon the roots of this community. It's yeah. what we're built on. It's our foundation. But now we've also become this, you know, this sophisticated community. It's a hub of politics for the northern part of the province. It's a hub of industry. It's a hub of yeah. Of medicine, of education. And seeing, coming here in 89, we were really on the ground floor of all of that, and just to be a part of everything that was exploding at the time was a thrill.
What was exploding in 89 when you
were here? Well, the arts and culture scene was exploding at the time, and I think that the movement towards diversifying the economy was really taking hold. Mm-hmm. In the late 80s, and it was so it was an exciting place to to be a part of, and right. be a young adult as you know, there was also a cultural revolution happening across North America in 89, 90, 91 too, so it was
right. in terms of music
and yeah in terms of music and you know, talking about politics too, it got me involved in not partisan politics, but mm-hmm. certainly being interested in looking at the world stage and being concerned with the the movements of the rest of the world and how it affected us, and the movements of other communities and how it affected us.
And sorry, if I can just interject.
Yeah.
One thing I find interesting about your candidacy is that you have a background in the arts. In social causes, but also in small business. I mean, mm-hmm. you know, when a band comes in, you can't pay them $1,000. You got to be able to justify it with business.
That's right.
You have to have customers. You know, you have a lot of practical experience. You know, the effect of new regulations from the province or the feds. What is that? How does that inform your candidacy? You know, how does that affect the way you look at, for example, the NDP platform, whether or not they're going to raise taxes and the impact? Because you know the impact that'll have on business. How does that
That's right.
candidacy?
Well, this is one of the things that I really like about the NDP platform is that they're very encouraging of small business, knowing that small business is an incredible job creator in this country. So lowering the taxes on small businesses from 11 to 9% allows small businesses to expand, to stay in business through the crucial early years of being a business, of building up your inventory, building up an inventory of staff as well, because you also want to you want to be able to afford to retain your staff, and this goes to trades businesses as well and construction businesses, where you want to be able to afford to retain your apprentices as they continue on in their experience and become journeymen and masters of their trades. You want to retain that knowledge, that skill set that you're developing, that you're investing in, and the NDP is about that. They encourage that, and it's
well. Let's talk about minimum wage. I mean, a lot of the staff at the townhouse, I assume, would work for minimum wage plus tips. The bar staff, that's mm-hmm. usually how it goes.
And it's going up 25 cents on.
Yeah, when minimum wage goes up, what kind of impact does that have on the business?
Well, it's something that we have to look at. You look at sales reports, you look at sales trends, and look at the costs of your inventory. Is your inventory price going up? What is the projected forecast for inventory? And if it is going up, then you may have to levy a price increase to the customers in order to afford to continue paying your staff, continue maintaining the buildings, and that because it's these are all factors that you have to work into every day.
So when you hear talk of raising the minimum wage, does a small business part of you say, you know, this is going to be a challenge for a lot of businesses because you know the effect it's going to have?
No, because when you raise wages, when people make more money, then they have more money to spend. They live in it's a difference between eating out one night a week or one night a month, or you know, and it's a difference between going to supporting to see live bands on the weekend or staying at home and playing a PlayStation. When people make more money, then they're out and spending it. They're out interacting with their community, and that's good for small business.
Why is it important for, you know, a national economy to support people in terms of, you know, having a minimum wage that would be considered livable? Why is that an important thing for a social democracy like Canada to make an important issue?
Well, because people in a social democracy, which I mean that the NDP dreams of being a government for. We don't want people to have to choose between rent or food. We don't want people to choose between food or medicine. We don't want people, and a livable wage. And this is one of the things that we get into with Tom Mulcair's plan to have a $15 federal minimum wage. So federally regulated industries. It's over 100,000 jobs. This is a great point. A great portion of our community that needs a raise, that gets a livable wage.
Mm-hmm. And critics of that $15 minimum wage will say basically you're killing investment.
It doesn't kill investment. The tax revenue comes back from higher wages. It goes back into your community. It goes back into the coffers. You look at any economist will project the 400,000 manufacturing jobs that have been lost. Mm-hmm. If we had those 400,000 manufacturing jobs in Ontario, the tax revenue from those 400,000 jobs would have negated the Ontario provincial debt in recent years. And that's economists will say that. And when we go to our to economists with a platform, with a framework, and say, can we afford to do this? And the economists will say, well, look at the numbers and say, yes, you can invest in manufacturing, you can invest in those jobs, yeah. And the tax base will return, will come back in, and you will be able to afford this. And this is why we're, happy to release a balanced platform.
Maybe we can move to some more local issues.
Sure.
Mailey Drive has been something that's been discussed a bit. We had David Robinson here in a bit. A little while ago, and he seems convinced that you've changed your position on Mailey Drive. I just wonder, what are your thoughts on Mailey Drive? Why do you support it? Why do you think it's a good plan?
Yeah, well, there's
you're clear you support Mailey.
Yes.
Okay. You're saying you misheard the question at the
question. There was a loud debate room. There was the
audio was really bad.
Yeah, the sound is not designed to travel across that table between people. There's other people talking. I think I hear David Robinson say, are you going to throw this out? And we said, no, we're not going to throw this out, because Mailey Drive is going to be an important part of moving product around this community, moving supplies around this community. And when now this is going to be in negotiation with Tom Davies Square, right? When the city of Sudbury says this is the important project that we need to work on, then the NDP is going to be your government that says we're going to go to Ottawa and get that funding, and we're going to make this happen. And we hope that the province will still be there as well.
There are those who'd say that we should be spending money on repairing our existing roads, on investing in transit and cycling infrastructure, instead of just another massive new building project. How do you react to that?
We'll defer to the experts in the community who say, if they say we need this first, then we're going to fight for that infrastructure funding first, for whether it's cycling infrastructure or repairing downtown roads or whatever. There's a lot of parts of this community that need better wastewater and access to hydro, and rural parts of the community that need access to broadband. So if that's the infrastructure that we need to fix first, and then we fix Mailey Drive, then that's the order that we do it in.
So we are you so are you saying that we should do Mealy because the experts say that we need to do Mealy? Because there's guys like David Robinson who will swear up and down that Mealy is a waste of money, it's totally unnecessary, you know, that you're just throwing good money after bad. So why do we need it? Why do we need Mealy?
Well, I think that a lot of the proponents of the Mealy Drive expansion I mean, if you look online, you see the videos of a circle, a ring road going all the way around the community, which I was, you know, it's interesting to look at those designs. The expansion of Mealy Drive initially for a lot of years in this community has been discussed to get the heavy slurry trucks off of LaSalle Boulevard,
right,
to reduce traffic congestion. There's a lot of economic loss in traffic congestion. There's a lot of accidents. There's a lot of time wasting. So if we can relieve that congestion, then that's what Mealy Drive is going to do. Is going to give us another artery to get our product to where it needs to be for processing. So whether it's getting the slurry trucks off of LaSalle Boulevard or getting and preserving the length of life of the inner city arteries, so that we don't have to fix them every 12 years, we fix them every 20 years. Then that's going to be the benefits of having an expanded Mealy Drive.
Yeah. So in short, the critics are wrong. They're wrong. We do need Mealy. Is that what you're saying?
It's yeah. Well.
David Robinson is wrong. You can say it, Paul.
I'm not going to. What the current city's administration has said, yeah, is that Mealy Drive is not their number one project right now.
Yeah.
So and we'll defer to that. If it's not their number one project right now, then we'll fight for other things.
I think what Robinson was saying or is saying is that there's a lot of message speak. I'm sure everyone's heard about that, where candidates are instructed to follow the party line and not vary from that. And Mulcair has a reputation as being extremely disciplined. How free are you? How free are you to speak on? You know, do you feel like you could say, well, you know, the party supports this, but I'm not really at all keen on it. But overall, I support the package. Or how much freedom do you have to speak, sort of off the NDP book?
I'm not really sure. I haven't really looked at. I haven't come across anything in the NDP book. In the playbook that really contravenes what I personally believe. I think that, and I think that's sort of naturally why I'm carrying around an orange binder, is because it works, is because it's sensible things. Having to work within the framework of a team is very important on this. Now, we do want to get to Parliament and we want to speak on behalf of our constituents. What we definitely won't see with an NDP government is where members of Parliament won't be able to speak up on behalf of their constituents. And I think what we have seen in Parliament in the last 10 years under Prime Minister, the current Prime Minister and the Conservatives, is that their own party can't speak on behalf of their constituents. It must be very frustrating that you can't go to Ottawa and fight on behalf of the issues of your home, especially when it comes to members in BC wanting to speak on traditional hunting lands, wanting to speak on protecting and our members in the north, wanting to speak on protecting rivers and protecting, and scientists in Ottawa not being able to speak on climate change. It's very frustrating to be muzzled, and that's why the Conservative government needs to be replaced.
Now, talking about muzzling, if there was an issue that was very passionately supported by people in your riding, because, I mean, there's a good chance you're going to be elected, would you be able to speak out against it? Would you keep it inside the party, your disagreement, or just how would you handle something like that, where something that, you know, your constituents clearly want, but it runs counter to party policy? How would you handle that?
Well, we go to the party and we say, how do we work on this? You know, we're a team. How do we work on this? This is a concern that needs to be addressed, and the NDP is one of the things that we want is to be able to have that discussion, And it's why Tom Mulcair is also saying he's gonna have the provinces in on these discussions as well. He'll meet with the premiers. He will meet with people and discuss solutions and meet with other parties and discuss solutions. The NDP will find creative solutions to problems. And if it's not in the playbook, then we'll find out, you know, how to get it in there.
Okay. You come from a music. I want to just talk a bit about your candidacy for a second, if mm-hmm. I could. Now, you come from a musical background. You played in a lot of punk bands when you were younger. Mm-hmm. You still play in bands today.
Still playing bands. Love it.
One of the sort of cornerstones of the punk movement, being a pretty big punk fan myself, is that do-it-yourself, is that DIY ethic that comes out of,
yes,
you know, sort of the 80s hardcore scene and all that sort of stuff. So is that a philosophy that sort of attracted you to punk? And does that play a role in your, because punk is a very political musical movement.
Absolutely.
Does that play a role, does that color your view of politics or how you practice politics?
I bet you
today.
Were expecting a punk rock question, were you?
You know, that's all right, because it's a very comfortable subject. It's the role of DIY ethics in politics today is that we do need, as politics and politicians, we do need to get involved in our communities and be a part of the change in our communities. Because we have to replace the cynicism of years of conservative corruption and liberal corruption. We need to replace that cynicism with hope and optimism, you know. And that's the DIY ethic. Yes, it means that I punch holes in my own paper and I cut. I still collate all the thank you letters and write them by hand If the power goes out, I go and find out what's wrong with the electrical panel, and I will serve the community that way as well. If there's something wrong in the community, then I want to be on site to figure out what it is and how can I help. So that's okay. You know, and I think that punk rock has always been. It's music of change, music of hope, and it's the same as jazz music in the 1930s and folk music. You know, I've been programming a folk festival for 16 years. It's music that hopes for a better community, that looks for solutions, mm-hmm. and also states what's wrong with the current community as well. So we should never shy away from that. We should never be afraid to have a discourse about what's wrong with your community. And I don't think with an NDP government you won't find that we'll shy away from that discourse.
Which leads me to my next question. What are the, give me three things in this city you were saying, you shouldn't shy away from fixing the things that need fixing in your community. What needs fixing in Sudbury? And what can a federal politician, do?
Well, we need to secure stable investments in the infrastructure in our community. There's been a lot of time has passed now, and we need to consider how our community is going to function 50 years, 100 years. We need a stable plan, and we need to be able to have long distance planning, a 30,000 foot view of where our community is going to be in a few decades' time. What kind of infrastructure are we going to pass down to our children? What kind of debt are we going to pass down to our children? We need to consider those things. We need to invest in healthcare in our community. Mm-hmm. We have an aging population, and federal politics. The conservatives have gutted healthcare and have not continued to transfer a proper amount of money to maintain a healthcare system. Mm-hmm. And the NDP will reverse that. We want to establish a national pharmacare program. We want to make sure that healthcare gets the leadership that it needs from the federal level to the provincial level, to make sure that we can provide access to health care for the North, and especially for our aging population, mm-hmm. and especially for remote communities as well, to make sure that that the health of our community is at the forefront of growing a healthy community.
We have some pretty big local infrastructure needs. We've talked about Maley.
We do.
There's a big roads deficit. There's a big water sewer deficit. Yes. But there's also other projects. We need a new arena desperately. We've been trying to get a performing arts center. For a long time.
Oh, yes.
I know the NDP is talking about increasing annual infrastructure money for cities, about $1.5 billion a year. I think I read that this morning. How would that play out in terms of some of the city's infrastructure projects? Would, for example, a new arena be eligible for that kind of funding?
Well, we hope so. We would hope that all of the projects will get a listed priority from the city. And we'll find out how much money we can get. And the main thing is that if we promise the money to the community, that it will get used in the community, that it doesn't get pulled away from the community. You know, like we don't want to have a thing where the Conservative government promises money to FedNor and then doesn't use that money and pulls it back into. Into their own, you know, general accounts. We need to have the money that's promised for Sudbury land here and go into the construction, into the projects that it's earmarked for. So yeah, there's an important list of projects. We do need more capacity for sports, for entertainment, for cultural events. And I've sat on those committees for many years, and hoped that we could get the list of assets expanded, and you know, and we've done these things with the Arts and Culture Advisory Panel, where we've collected all of the inventory of the arts community, and I think that the arts community understands itself a lot better now. Because the city has run those committees, and they've been great idea factories to be a part of, and we know that there's a lot of people in the community that are moving towards that, will move towards performing arts centers, and there's at least two ideas that are sort of racing towards the finish line right now that we've seen releases for this year. So
yeah.
You know, I'm excited. I'm a fan of watching those. Those develop.
We have some other issues, but I want to just explore that one a little bit with you, just in terms of economics. I mean, we've had to turn away some pretty big name acts from Sudbury Arena because it just can't handle their sound system or whatever. You know, there's various reasons that we've had to turn away some big ones, right? We put in a performing arts center. Can the city make a significant amount of money off of being able to offer some of these bigger name acts that aren't able to come to Sudbury because we just don't have the infrastructure for them? I mean, is there money there that can be made for the city, for businesses in the city, or is it just, you know, or is it just a sort of, well, you know, we are the major city in Northern Ontario. It's stupid that we don't have a performing arts center. So just for the sake of our own ego, you know, we should spend the money on a performing arts center.
You don't do it for ego. You don't do it for money. That's, I'll tell you, after 22, 25 years of bringing music to the community, it's not a get-rich-quick scheme. It is a long life of hard, diligent work, but you do it for the community. You do it because people want to see a good concert. You do it because people want to bring their children to an interesting symphony concert. And so a performing arts center, yes, it can make money. Will it need subsidies? You know, maybe there are some things that there are definite art projects that can be subsidized, and there are you know, there is arts funding to help with specific projects getting them off up and launched. What you want to do is you want to work towards a sustainable model, so you have a plan. A strategic plan in place where you say, okay, yes, we did access Canadian Heritage funding or Northern Ontario Heritage Fund funding this year, but that's an investment towards 5 years from now being able to live as a sustainable entity where we pay our staff, we pay our technical directors, and we put on concerts and sustain that. you know, and it's by diversifying. It's by having a cultural center where you have lessons being taught and generate revenue from that. If it's a lot of space in the building, then you have a retail space, you have rental space, you have revenue from rehearsals and, mm-hmm. and things like that. Your building has to be efficient and has to the plan has to break even.
It has to break even. But I kind of got the, so you're saying it has to break even, but I kind of also got the impression there that you're saying that in a way it's not so important if it makes money, because you know, art is its own reward in many respects. Like the benefits that it brings socially to the community are worth, you know, the cost if you have to subsidize it in some respects. Is that fair? Is that what you're saying? Or?
The standard model for financing your arts in your community is that the artistic dollars that are spent in your community have a multiplier of about 3.5, and we've shown that as the board of Folk Music Ontario have done studies with all of our local festivals and seen how many, you know, hundreds of thousands of jobs arts and culture provides to the community,
right,
to the country in a year, mm-hmm. and that all of that money does multiply. Is that the paying the artists, paying the money that's generated in the restaurants all around mm-hmm. the art center, the money that's generated by hotels and that, it stimulates the economy to a good factor, 3.5. It's
an investment, not an expense, I
yeah.
guess. Is.
Okay, and so on a year that that an art center doesn't have a surplus, mm-hmm. then there should be room for balance of budget. You need to see it as a long-term plan.
Okay.
Of we'll keep the doors open. You don't close the country, you know, the first time you run a deficit, but you do have to have a plan to eventually make that money back and,
for sure.
and not burden future generations with that debt.
Yep.
And an art center is going to function the same way.
If I could just switch gears for a second. Your party's talked about cutting taxes for small business, but raising corporate taxes. And in a community like Sudbury, where so many people rely on mining jobs, good paying mining jobs, who might be concerned about what that would mean for them, because Valet and Glencore and the other mining companies are quite large, what would you say to them?
The amount of tax that is going to be raised is going to, now the federal corporate income tax, the CIT, is about 15% right now, and Tom Mulcair is proposing to raise it to 17%, which will still be within the average of what the corporate income tax was in the last 10 years. So we're just saying restore it to the level that it was at in the last 10 years. We're still competitive with other jurisdictions around us. We're still below the corporate tax rate of other G7 countries, well below the United States corporate tax rate. Still competitive. So
okay, that's
Tom Mulcair's plan will work in that way, because it will generate a significant amount of revenue for the country, and to make sure that large corporations don't get tax breaks free of charge. You know, you get tax breaks, and there's lots in the book where we talk about, you create a job, you get a tax break, innovation tax incentives and mm-hmm. and things like that. Create a job, get a tax break.
So you're talking about a moderate increase in corporate taxes, a cut in small business taxes, $15 a day, you know, child care for everyone, 41,000 or 7,000 new doctors and nurses. I mean, there's a lot of expensive problems or promises, plus you're going to balance the budget. And I just wonder, you know, how do all those numbers add up?
It's the framework that we've released has been checked by economists who have been president of the Canadian Economic Association, and they say that it balances. This is a costed framework that does pay for itself. The revenue is there. The spending that we've promised, and including the spending on in northern Ontario to invest in northern Ontario. It all comes out of a balanced framework. So, the numbers are there. We can, you know, please look it up online. I'm not going to bore everybody with the exact numbers.
I guess
it has been costed.
Maybe yes. to reframe that question a little bit more. All of the parties are, you know, obviously we're in an election campaign. All of the parties are making these massive promises. You know, we're going to spend this. We're going to balance that. We're going to blah 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 blah. But you're asking people to vote for you here in Sudbury. So why should they believe that? Like, why should they believe the NDP over the promises of the Liberals or over the promises of the Tories or, you know, over the promises of the Green Party for the four people who are going to vote for them?
People should vote for the NDP because this platform is, this costed budget is something that will work. It will protect pensions. It will invest in daycare, stimulate the economy in the middle. We make sure that the middle class and the working class aren't paying an overburden of the tax debt. Mm-hmm. You vote for the NDP because we're social democrats, because we want to fight for equality in the community. As you know, as far if you want to talk economics, we believe that the economic model works, where you invest in a wide range of things from seniors to children and education and healthcare, mm-hmm. and it stimulates your economy, and it's a good community to live in. You know, and to argue economic theories is one thing, and we'll go to the mat on that. We'll argue that our economic theory works. The other reasons you vote for the NDP are that social democracy works for your community. Mm-hmm. It works for creating equality. It works for fighting for justice for our First Nations communities, and making sure that they've got food and schools, and making sure that our foods are protected, and making sure that our lakes and our rivers are protected, mm-hmm. and making sure that we can fight climate change. And that's that is what the NDP stands for as, you know, as an emotional political entity, is that we want to create a more equal society that has a sustainable model that is not going to burden its children with debt.
One of your biggest customer bases at the townhouse are university students. Mm-hmm. And I haven't heard a lot about what the NDP plan is for university, for tuition fees, for making education more affordable for, you know, university college level. Maybe you could just talk about a bit about that.
There is more education announcements forthcoming, and the focus so far has been to make sure that that life is affordable for people, that we invest in affordable housing, that we invest in public transportation in a community, and that's a big part of infrastructure spending as well, is making sure that public transportation gets the proper investment.
Should we expect to hear anything about tuition relief?
We'll expect to hear that, yeah. And I'm looking forward to it. It's because we know that the student debt of the country is $23 billion is the student debt of the country, and it's one of the places that that we need to work on, and we have talked about a lot, is investing in getting in youth employment. And making sure that when you get out of university, you've got a debt, you're going to make sure that you're getting a job that pays, that gives you a fighting chance, mm-hmm. to participate in the economy. So that means defending unpaid internships. That means defending against unpaid internships. You want to make sure that people are getting paid fairly for the work that they're doing, and that internships are subject to other labor laws protection for occupational health and safety reasons, that you don't just hire an intern and send them in to do all the dirty work, that's not what a student or a recent graduate needs their work experience to be. They yeah. need a dignified work experience that builds their skill set and earns them money, allows them to participate in the economy.
In 2011, you shocked a lot of people when you almost beat Rick Bartolucci. I think you shocked all the people in your own party, as a matter of fact.
I think you shocked yourself a little.
you know, you really came out of nowhere. And since then, you've run for the nomination for a couple of times, and now you're back. So this isn't your first campaign. And I wonder if you can articulate to me what you've learned about the political process in that time. Because, you know, one thing people in politics knows is that nomination meetings are often more dirty and nasty than the actual campaigns. It's all that stuff that's going on. How have you evolved as a candidate? How has your sort of view of party politics and the rawness, you know, how's that changed you as a candidate? What's your view of it?
I'll say this, is that the nomination meeting that I went through this year was the most positive nomination experience that I've been through. And it gives you reborn faith in the political process, reborn faith in the NDP, that we are a party that will work together as a team to achieve the best goals for a community. I know from previous campaigns that you need to get a good amount of sleep, and you need to take care of yourself, and you need to make sure you're eating lots of fruit and stretching in the morning before you go walking every day, knocking on doors.
Wasn't it hard for you, though, when Suzanne Chabaniquit ran in the Sudbury by-election? You must have been wondering, because really nobody knew who she was. You were running. You came so close in 2011. Everyone kind of assumed that the party would just line up behind you and you would get the nomination, yet, I mean, she kind of came out of left field. What was that process like for you?
It was really interesting. I was I was in Montreal when the news broke that we were going to have a by-election, and the first thought is would I run? You know, well, I talked to my partner at home and talked to my employers and talked to my friends and say, you know, is this it? Should I get in it again? And initially it was, yeah, let's do this. And we start looking around the community, and this is what we do any festival is going to do this, any business is going to do this. You have a succession plan. You have to have ideas in mind. So they're not just going to rubber stamp a candidate. The NDP doesn't just rubber stamp a candidacy. We're going to do a full search of the community, of the assets in the community, who fights for social justice, who is a person who has done a lot of community work. And when Suzanne's name came up, at the same time that we were learning that there was also going to be a federal vacancy, then there's a decision that had to be made, and my decision was, I like Suzanne. I worked with her 20 years ago at the Northern Lights Festival Boreal.
She's also in the artistic community.
She's been in the artistic community. She's been working in education. She's been working in a lot of different fields that gave her a good profile and a good understanding of provincial issues, and I decided at that time, I said, I would vote for Suzanne.
So that was your decision?
So I said, no, I'm going to support Suzanne. I'm going to help nominate Suzanne and helped work on her nomination campaign, and then helped on her the provincial campaign, and said at that time, and I'm doing this, and I'm going to step up and put my name in for the federal race as well. So that was
all your decision?
So that was all my decision. That's been the last 10 months. That happened in at the end of December, and we've been running ever since, and building capacity as a team since then. And that's why this has been a very rewarding year, is because the team building capacity of the NDP has hopefully will show the community that we are the only team that you need to represent you in Ottawa. And eventually we'll show you that the NDP is the team that you need to represent you in Toronto as well.
You're polling pretty well in Sudbury, from what we've seen. You've got a fairly comfortable lead from what we've seen on projections.
Would you believe me if I say that I haven't looked?
No, I wouldn't. But that's okay. We'll take you at your word. How about that? But what I was curious about is, I lost my train of thought on that question where I was going with the polling.
I can say this.
Oh, yes, I know.
The poll that matters is
the one on election day. Yes, I know. Yes. Blah, blah. We've heard that before, Paul. No, what I wanted to know was this. You're polling fairly well here in Sudbury. You've got a reasonably comfortable lead from the projections that we've seen. What I'm curious about, though, is do you think that Glenn Thibault's defection harmed the NDP in the riding, or do you think that it harmed the Liberals and helped the NDP? I know it's a hard question to answer, but I'm curious your thoughts on what happened there.
Well, I think the best answer is that Glenn Thibault has to answer that. Hmm. And that'll be for him to answer. I think what we do need to consider is that for whatever decision he made, he answers for. Mm-hmm. But we can't let people become more cynical about politics because of it. Mm-hmm. We can't. We have to fight against the cynicism. And I hear this at the door, where people say, "Oh, you guys are just you're gonna quit. You're all in it for yourselves. There's things that the cynicism that is out there that has risen in recent years we need to combat against that, and we need to make sure that people know that they can trust politics, that they can trust that we can build a system that people can that can deliver promises. Mm-hmm. We can the NDP can deliver government services in an efficient manner that gets to the community, and if people don't have if people do find the Kafkaesque wall of bureaucracy facing them, then they walk into their NDP office, and I've got a 5-point harness and a grappling hook, and we climb that wall, and we take those silos down, we take those walls down, and make government understandable, and we make government friendly, and we make government work for people.
Do you think coming from an arts background helps you in that regard, in dealing with people, in dealing with that cynicism and
Artistic thinking will find creative solutions. I have a good experience in sitting around tables and saying, okay, we need these solutions. Let's come up with some ideas. Let's have strengths, weaknesses, opportunity, threats, right? Do a good SWOT analysis of your situation and come up with the creative ideas that you can build on and have a plan. It is a combination of left brain and right brain thinking, because you have to consider the numbers as well. And I have a good math brain. I've been doing counted a lot of things over the years and done a lot of inventories and that. So running a small business will give you a good experience for that, for considering all of the aspects of moving your project forward, considering all of the aspects of delivering government to a community. Mm-hmm. And considering all of the aspects of delivering the community's needs and wants to the floor in Ottawa.
Okay. Oh, if I can ask you a bit about more of a national issue, the oil sands is a controversial development. There's a lot of environmentalists who are not comfortable with it. The Green Party saying that most of it should stay in the ground. I believe the NDP is against Keystone but pro oil sands. And I'm just wondering maybe if you can articulate exactly what the party's outlook on the oil sands is.
Tom has been very clear in saying sometimes we need to get our product to market. We have to do it safely. We have to have the proper environmental impact studies done, and we have to make sure that those communities the product is going to move through are not harmed. This goes back to rail safety as well, right? You don't want GoGamma to worry about what's happening in their backyard. We want our communities to be safe. We do want to participate in business. We do want to, as long as we are using this as a fuel source, as an energy source, then we need to get it to market. We need to do it safely, and we need to build, get our tradespeople working, building the proper pipeline if we can do it safely.
Do you think there's a way to extract the bitumen and not damage the environment in a serious way? I mean, we've all seen the pictures of, you know, some of the effects of some of the extraction so far, and then they can be a bit disturbing.
I am a sociologist. I am not an environmental biologist, so I have not done those studies on extracting bitumen from. I've read the articles as well.
I think maybe what Darren is saying, sorry not to interrupt you, but you know, Sudbury, you know, obviously has a reputation for you know, sort of damaging the environment simply by being a resource extraction center. But we've done a lot of work, you know, and there has been a lot of work done over the decades to try and mitigate the damage that's done by those resource extraction in terms of, you know, hard rock mining.
That's right.
And you know, tailings and emissions and all that sort of stuff. I think what Darren is saying is that there doesn't seem to have been the same level of environment of importance placed on protecting the environment around the oil sands in Alberta as perhaps there has been here.
Well, what I'm saying is there a way to extract the bitumen and not do serious damage to the environment, which is basically the debate. I mean, is it possible because of the nature of the resource?
Yeah. Well, you know? we need to invest in the technology to make sure that we can do that. You know, and that's where an innovation tax credit is going to be an attractive thing to a company, to university researchers, to get in there and say, we have this valuable resource in the ground. We have a vast valuable resource of chromite in Northern Ontario that the NDP want to develop as well. How do we get that out of the ground? How do we get that to market? You know, so we need to invest in the infrastructure. We need to invest in the science to do it safely. You know, where is the technology? I'm not currently working on it, so I hope it's in the science labs at universities and other extraction companies and that right now. I hope that their scientists are working on it and we'll have a solution to get that out. It's you know, the same issues that we fought 100 years ago with getting pulp from paper and 200 years ago with pulp from paper and 100 years ago with getting nickel from the ground here. How do we do it efficiently? And the lesson that Sudbury can teach them is you don't want to pay with your environment for 100 years. And you know, now the last few decades in Sudbury, we've cleaned that up. But we don't want the tar sands, the oil sands, to have to spend 100 years cleaning.
Would pre-2011 Paul Loenberg be as open-minded toward the oil sands as NDP, federal NDP candidate Paul Loenberg is?
I hadn't considered that. It's you know, of course the oil sands haven't weren't in the news as much in 10 years ago, and it's gonna it'll also change depending on the cost of a barrel of oil in this world, and that's. And that affects our markets, just like the price of nickel affects everything that happens in Sudbury. So we need to, we need to consider these things. We need to consider new technologies. We need to.
So is that a yes or a no? Sorry. would you have been as open-minded toward the oil sands? I mean, I guess what I'm really asking is how much do you have to censor a lot of your maybe personal opinions to be able to be part of a team like, you know, that has a chance of getting government?
I would say that the younger me is still interested in how we extract resources in our community, and I've always been concerned about whether or not we can do it safely and sustainably for our environment. You know, and that's always going to be my hope, is that we do it, as long as we're extracting resources from our ground, we do it sustainably. We do it with respect to the environment. We do it with respect to the land that we're extracting it from.
Okay. The NDP has never formed a national government here. Why is now?
Not yet.
Why is 2015 the time that Canada is ready to have an NDP government?
After 10 years of Stephen Harper, life has become more difficult. Life has become more unaffordable. There's never been a greater opportunity to turn that around, to get that message to people than under Tom Mulcair. Now we've been the official opposition for the last 4 years. So Tom Mulcair has proved day after day that he goes toe-to-toe with the Prime Minister and calls him on decisions that the government is making. And I hope that the people of Canada have been watching this and will consider that if we want to defeat the government of Stephen Harper, the best way to do that is to elect Tom Mulcair as the Prime Minister. It's near 100 seats. So the becoming either the senior partner in a minority government or becoming a majority government is far less of a distance to run than choosing another party for government. So the NDP is well positioned to be in that leadership position, and by having a platform that really addresses the wide array of things that we're going to come up against in our economy, in our health, in our lives, personal lives, we're showing to people that we take a balanced approach to government, that we're going to, that we've put the thought into this, that we're ready to govern, mm-hmm. because we've considered this, and we have your lives at our interest.
I was here in the early 1980s when Sudbury accepted several people, refugees from Southeast Asia. They're called the boat people. I'm not sure if that's still a proper term to use. But, I mean, people were really excited to help them and to bring them in. There's a current refugee crisis that's a bit more complicated because of the fear of ISIS and the infiltrators. I wonder how MP Paul Loewenberg would handle that. Would you be sponsoring families perhaps coming to Sudbury or promoting that, facilitating that to happen? And how would you address the fears that some people have about, you know, that certainly some parties are playing on, but people have fears about accepting refugees from that part of the world?
I don't think we should have those fears. I think that we need to do our work, and as a member of Parliament, I'm excited to be able to greet some new people to come into our community. I think it's diversifying your community, learning more about the world, is going to help everybody. And we need to, we do need to do it properly. The introduction of communities and refugees from a civil war is going to be a tricky thing. This is why we need to make sure that. That our border security is good. We don't. This is a troublesome thing. We've heard about the Harper Conservatives putting this bill C-51 out to defend our Canadian interests against against terrorism and that. Now the NDP were the only party to oppose that, because we said it goes too far. It places unfair targets on anybody who organizes anything in this country. So we've been opposed to it from the start. And if Stephen Harper is that concerned about about national security, why has he told the Public Service Alliance of Canada that by 2017 they're going to lay off another 1,100 or eliminate another 1,100 border security jobs? You know, how is that saying that he's concerned about the security of the country when they're going to reduce the amount of security that we have? You know, under an NDP government, we invest in bringing people into this country. We want to be leaders in a compassionate world, and that also means peacekeepers. But welcoming people to our country, we need to do it. We need to make sure that the tens of thousands of people that are looking to us mm-hmm. for a home, that they find a welcoming home here.
Do you believe some of Harper's critics who, and I'm sure I can probably predict the answer to this, but I'm going to ask it anyway. You know, with Canada's stance on the refugee situation from the Middle East, with Canada's with Harper's sort of.
It's interesting that mid campaign that we actually got policy changed. We actually got in there and made the Prime Minister adjust their policy, and that's the power that strong voices can have, united voices can have.
Okay. So. But do you, and Harper's been criticized by, you know, some high profile liberals, but some others as well, for ruining Canada's global reputation with the greenhouse gas emissions, with the refugee thing. Is there truth in that, do you think?
Oh, absolutely.
And why should we care?
It's shameful. It's shameful that we pulled out of the Kyoto Accords, that the Prime Minister is not meeting the First Ministers to talk about reducing greenhouse gases and battling climate change. It's shameful that the Prime Minister has pulled us out of these kinds of talks, that we're not engaging with the world as peacekeepers as we have in past generations. Mm-hmm. You know, we do need to be out there. We do need to be this voice of we're a country that has the potential for wealth and development, and so we also need to be the country that has this potential for compassion and sitting around the table at the UN. We need to be around the table with other developed countries and saying, here's talks that we need to have, mm-hmm. I'm ashamed that our Prime Minister has tarnished our international reputation. And
strong words. Anything else you wanted to?
Should we expect to see Tom Mulcair in town before the end of the election?
Oh, the leaders' tour is a very very. Fluid moving
target
and we hope so. There's talk of it. We'll find out in 4 or 5 days before it happens, because it's a very fluid moving mechanism, now he was here the week that the writ was issued, and we had good meetings in the morning, and we had public appearance, and then we did a swing across the north. We went to from Sudbury to Sturgeon Falls and to North Bay, and talked about a lot of northern issues. What I am excited about as well is that Tom Mulcair and the NDP recognize that Northern Ontario is a unique territory in the country, so we have a northern platform, and that is something that only the NDP have brought out, is the northern platform, and it shows that the NDP are, while Tom is battling a battle in 338 ridings, that a northern platform proves that our 10 ridings of the north are important to them.
You guys trade beard stories while you were here? While he was here?
We did.
Beard the new black? Is that the way it works?
Is beard the new black?
Is he beards everywhere?
There's beards everywhere. Beard a part of it.
Yours is much trimmer now, though. I remember
I did have quite a large beard last year.
Is that your one concession to politics, that you kind of have too crazy a beard?
I don't know. I worked for Jerry Montpellier.
Yeah, that's true.
It's, in running for politics, you want to appeal to a wide range of people. We have to work with everybody in the community. Mm-hmm. So,
including people who like beards.
Including people who like beards. Does image management come into a campaign? Of course it does. It's also another thing to say that we should hold our politicians to the highest standards of integrity as well, and we should hold our politicians to the highest standards of representation in our community. And
I could be wrong. Would Mulcair not be our first bearded prime minister? I'm trying to think of somebody else. Way back.
Oh, there's been some pretty wicked mutton chops.
There have been some good mutton chops. There have been some good stashes and things, but I can't think of another PM. No, I can't think of one.
Yeah. Okay. Well,
one last question for me. I don't know if it's going to help our audience out at all, but it'll certainly answer some things for me. 80s hardcore punk bands, are you a Black Flag guy or are you a Dead Kennedys guy? This will help me.
Wow. Essentially, I'm a Dead Kennedys guy.
Interesting. Yeah. Okay. That helped me. All right.
I did bring Jello Biafra to the city of Sudbury.
Really?
I didn't know that. Years ago, we brought him, we had him at Sudbury Secondary for a talking gig.
Oh, that would have been
awesome. It was amazing. And he's a... the thing I have always liked about the Dead Kennedys was that Jello puts the politics and talking about
right up
the community right up front. And he's talked about a great deal about censorship issues and a great deal about the value of artistic work.
Yeah, and he certainly has. And the working man.
Yeah, and the working man, and it's, I've met them both. I'm also a Henry Rollins fan and a Des Cadena fan, but for me, the Dead Kennedys is...
All right. Thanks, Paul.
Okay. Thank you.
I want to thank you for watching today. I want to thank Paul for joining us. I hope you learned a little something. I know that I learned quite a bit, and we want to thank you, and we hope you tune in again. Cheers.